Amen. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Glory to the name of God. Hallelujah. Jesus. He's so wonderful. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Mother. That's my mom. I may be her daughter-in-law, but that's my mom.
All right.
Glory to God. Thank you for that introduction. Amen. And we just give honor to God and His Spirit that is in control in this place.
Yes.
Hallelujah. That has truly come before us and set the atmosphere. Amen. Giving honor to my husband, Delvin Davis, in the back. Amen. Woo! My beautiful pastor, Pastor Yvonne Lewis. Amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. Glory to God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. All the clergy and lay people who have thought it not proper to gather themselves here and partake of what the Spirit has to say and has to do on today. Amen. Glory be to God. And the prayers are already going forth. Amen. The atmosphere is already set. Amen. As my mom said, this is a teaching ministry. And so I endeavor to just stand before you and declare the word of the Lord. Amen. The preaching anointing has not decided to rest on me as of yet. Glory to God. So I will stand before you and teach and declare the word of God. Glory to God. Amen. Our first teaching this morning is on the names of God. And I just want to thank God for Pastor Brown, who just came forth and just did the pre-message. Glory to God. Introduction to the message, to the demonstration of the teaching that is to go forth. Amen. The demonstration is already gone forth and now the teaching, because she demonstrated what it is to pray the names of God and how vital it is, and how the Spirit responds to His name. Glory to God. And how you feel and how you relate to those different characters and attributes of our Lord. Glory to God. And so we're just going to teach just a little bit, a few minutes, on the names of God.
Amen.
And so we know that there are many names, glory to God. I know some of the women have already shared with me this morning while I've been studying right in this topic, glory be to God.
Amen.
And so we're just going to give you just a little bit this morning to whet your appetite to keep on studying a little bit more, amen, to know Him further, glory to God. And so the premise of the teaching is that when you know that you need to share something with someone, if you need to share something in confidence, or if you need to ask for something, you determine who you go to in your circle by the character of the people that you know. Glory to God. And so when you're in need, you don't go to somebody who is known to always be in lack. When you're in need of a confidant, you don't go to someone whose character is that of a gossip. Amen. And so what we need and what we understand in the natural is that the character of a person determines our relationship with that person, how deep I'll go and how far I'll go with that person. Amen. And so we need to carry that over in the spiritual. We can't just know Him as God. We can't just know Him as Lord. If those names do have power, there's power in the name of Jesus. But we need to know the many attributes of God that can determine our relationship and draw us into relationship with Him. And so if we don't understand who God is and all that He encompasses, we won't be inclined to go to Him when we're in need. Glory to God. We won't be inclined to go to Him if you don't know Him as a confidant. Glory to God. Which is how it wastes away, and this thing is burning on the inside of me, and I need somebody to talk to. I need somebody to pour out my heart, and God is right there all the time. Your confidant. The one who sticks closer than a brother. The one who will never leave you. But if you don't know that that's the name and attribute of God, you won't go to Him. He's already given us an open invitation to ask, to seek, to knock, to knock. The door will be open. And you don't know what's on the other side of the door, you're not going in. And so we see the importance of knowing who God is. It's like looking at a building, and you see this huge edifice, and there's a door, there's one door. You know, some of us are nosy. Come on, we living in here, we nosy, we curious. And we walk out, we look, especially if you say, do not enter, give me your good. and we look and say, I wonder what's in it.
Right.
I wonder what's behind that door. There must be a vast storehouse of things behind that door. However, if we never turn it off.
My Lord.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Jesus.
And so ignorance is not bliss. The world has to say. Ignorance is not bliss. It's fatal.
Ignorance will force you to be like the horse who was led to the water.
It does not drink. Although he's moments from death, he's panting and about to die, he won't drink the water. Why? Because he doesn't know that his thirst, the attribute of the water is to quench his thirst. The attribute of the water is to give him life and to revive him. Glory to God. And so ignorance is not bliss. Ignorance is fatal, especially for the child of God. And so he stands there wishing someone will come. And I heard somebody say that, I believe it was Pastor Brown, that a lot of times we're waiting on God and we're waiting on somebody else to come and give us what God has already given us the ability to do. But it's in our mouth, it's in our head. The word that a night is closed and dear to me, even in our mouth. Glory to God. And so we already have everything that we need, yet because of ignorance, we fail to take advantage of it. And so the Lord stands there wishing somebody to just come along and just diagnose me and just save me, give me a cure. Glory to God. And everything that he needs, the word is a bad place right before him.
Yes.
All right. And so he dies. And so this is what happens to us when we wish. Yes. And we just have this vague hope, glory to God, for God to do something. Amen. It is vague. Because God is not responding to wishes. He's not responding to vague hope. He's responding to faith. Amen. And so we need to know the attributes of God. Or else we'll just waste away wishing for God to heal me, wishing for God to prosper me, wishing for God to elevate me. Glory to God. And so instead of and pray to Jehovah Rapha, he is the Lord who heals. Glory be to God. He's the same God yesterday, today, and forevermore. And this is why we need to know the name of God. He does not change. Glory to God. And so operating in the knowledge of who God is, which is his character, his attributes, is what spurs relationship. And then that relationship is what ignites faith. That crazy faith.
That's it.
Y'all heard of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego?
Right.
That's that crazy faith, glory to God. But it took them to know something. Their faith was in the God that they knew would not fail. Their faith was in the God that they knew was sovereign. They said, if he chooses, even if he does not choose to deliver me, all is well, all is well. I'm going into the fiery furnace, glory to God. I'm going into what looks like death. I'm going into what looks like it'll harm me. I'm going into what looks like in the faith. Glory to God. God's name is the manifestation of his character.
Yes, it is.
Turn to Proverbs chapter 18. And so the name of God is the manifestation of God in your life. If you're looking for healing to manifest, then you need to call on Jehovah Rapha. Amen.
Yes.
If you're looking for power, and then you need to call on Elohim.
Yes.
The God who created the heavens and the earth. He created everything in it. You and I. Glory to God.
Yes.
Proverbs 18, chapter verse 10. The name of the Lord is a strong fortress.
Alright.
The name of the Lord is a strong fortress.
Right.
The godly run to him and are safe.
Yes.
And so the Lord said his name. And then it ends up and says him. And so you see how the two are interchangeable. They're one of the same. God and the name of God. Amen. His name is his identity. We're going to go to the book of Exodus, chapter 3. And in Exodus 3, God sent Moses to Pharaoh and the Israelites. We all know the story. And he sent Moses to the Israelite slaves to tell them, the Lord has sent me to deliver you.
Yeah.
He sent them to Pharaoh to say, the Lord said, let my people go.
Yeah.
And so Moses had some knocky knees, as we all do sometimes, glory to God, some of us fall in on us. And so he began to question God, well, what should I say, God? And so God told him, well, just tell them the God of your ancestors has sent you. That was enough for Moses. Amen. Moses in Exodus chapter 3 verse 13, I'll read in the New Living Translation. It says, but Moses protested. If I go to the people of Israel and tell them, the God of your ancestors has sent me to you, they will believe me.
Yes.
They will ask, which God are you talking about?
Wow.
What is his name? Then what should I tell them?
Right.
And so even after the Lord had already assured Moses earlier on that I'll be with you, don't worry about it, Moses. Moses had to go a little bit further and say, God, well, what is your name?
Yeah.
And so why did he ask that? Because in that time, the society was accepted and understood that a person's name is his identity.
Yeah.
And so what Moses was really asking God is, God, reveal yourself to me. Reveal your character. Open up to me and let me see who you really are. Glory to God. And so he needed to know the character of God for himself. It wasn't enough for him to know that he was the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It wasn't enough to know. It's not enough for us to know that he's the God of my grandmother and my grandfather. That he said he's my mother's God and my daddy's God. It's not enough for us to know that. We need to know the character of God, the attributes of God for ourselves. And so we need to begin to ask God, what is your name? And you can ask him that according to the situation that you're facing. And the Spirit of God will reveal to you who he is in your particular situation. Glory to God. And so Moses needed to relate to God for himself. That was that yearning for relationship. God, I know you delivered Abraham. I know you did great things for Isaac and Jacob. I know you did all that, God, but I need to know you for myself. And so his curiosity was piqued, and he desired relationship with God.
Yeah.
And so knowing the names of God, along with his word, helps us to learn the character of God,
amen,
which strengthens our relationship with him. And so as we know, worshiping and praying the names of God gives you that extra. It's like putting gasoline on a fire.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. You already got the fire going. But when you begin to call on the names of God, it's like putting gasoline on that thing. And it just explodes. Glory to God. And so it shows respect and adoration to God, which pleases him. You don't understand that? Well, how about when you meet someone? You met them a week ago and they come back and you see them again and they don't remember your name. In fact, don't you take that as disrespect? You don't know me. I just saw you the other day. It shows respect to God. When you remember, you can recall his names before him. Amen. It means something to him when we remember his name. And it's their respect this and that for your own glory to God. But you need to have it in the forefront of your mind. So that at every moment, who God is to you. Glory to God. And so this will put you on the offense. See, Jesus Christ on the defense. I love the song that the pastor sang. I got authority to walk all over you. I got authority to come in your house and take that word.
Yeah.
That's like somebody said, I want you to come on here to Hawaii.
Yeah.
And I take care of all the expenses. All you record edge and ask him to sanctify you. Sanctify this temple, oh God. Set me apart for your use, oh Lord. Make me holy before you, oh God. And so I can keep your word and your statutes that I love so much. Redeemer.
Lord of God.
Isaiah 59 and 20. We are redeemed by the blood of Jesus. Therefore, we have no obligation to sin, which is our own master. That one is not only the Lord, but he's there. Glory to God, according to the Romans. Nailed to the cross with Jesus is there. Would you ask us for anything there? The analogy I always like to use if you are married and your husband dies. Would you still be walking around telling people I'm married?
My Lord.
And if you get an invitation, well, wait, I need to check with my husband. They'll be looking at you like, oh, you don't know that. You kind of crazy. And so we do the same thing. We are so flesh. And we let flesh have an opinion as to what we'll do or where we'll go. And it's a place to be made.
All right.
Redeemer.
All right, preacher.
Isaiah 64 and 8. And we need to know that he's in control. He shapes me and molds me to his good pleasure. And all I do is I just submit. God, have your way with me. Mold me as you see fit. Use me as you see fit. You're the potter, and I am but the clay. Again, I have no opinion. The clay doesn't tell the potter what to make of it. It's up to the potter. He's your shepherd. Ezekiel 34 and 23. The shepherd protects and feeds. The shepherd shelters the sheep. He guides the flock at all costs. Even at the expense of his very life. And so the Lord is my shepherd. If I know that, then when these things begin and lack tribes to come and creep in and lust begins to try to creep in and make me desire some things over there, I need to know the Lord is my shepherd. I have everything that I need. I don't need to know over there. God is my shepherd.
Yes.
If I follow him, he'll lead me.
Amen.
To the still waters. Glory to God. He'll restore my soul.
Yes.
Amen. There's safety following the shepherd. There's provision following the shepherd.
Yes.
He's your wall of fire.
Yes.
And Zechariah 2 and 5. My God, when I saw the scripture, he said, my Lord, we often pray and hold the compounded ministries for the fire of God.
Yes.
So when I saw that he's a wall of fire, think about a wall of fire. No predator, no sin, no enemy can penetrate a wall of fire. There's so much safety and comfort in knowing that he is my shield. He shields me with his very fire. Glory to God. Nothing can penetrate in anything that tries to be consumed and burn up in the flames. Hallelujah. Glory to God. He's no refiner. Malachi 3 and 3. He purges me from all impurities and makes me just like pure gold. My God. He's my Emmanuel. Matthew 1 and 23. God is always with me. He's always present with me. No matter where I go, I don't need to be afraid.
All right.
The scripture says, don't be afraid of men in their faces. You need to just go. I'm with you. Glory to God. He's my Emmanuel. He's a friend of sinners. Matthew 11 and 19. And what that means is while I was yet in my sin, Jesus was my friend. He was a friend that gave his life for me while I was yet a sinner. He's a friend of sinners. Amen. He's my beloved. Matthew 12 and 8. And then the Song of Solomon, this term is used so many times. And the Song of Solomon is not just about the two lovers. It's about the love affair between you and your God.
Right.
And so when you see those words of love and adoration and longing, that's the way that we need to approach God.
Right.
When we pray, God, you are beloved. You're the apple of my eye. You're the little heartthrob, oh God. I just adore you. I long to be with you, oh God. When my prayer time is over, Lord, just be with me throughout the day and I'll meet you here again as soon as I can, oh God. I just love you so much, my beloved. Make him your beloved, the apple of your eye. Give him all of your affection and your devotion, amen. And so praying that names of God, if your prayers sometimes become a little bit mundane and repetitious, amen. If it becomes, sometimes you find yourself at kind of a stalemate. You know, when it's like, okay, well, what do I pray now? You know, you feel the Spirit of God, but what do I pray now? That's right, get into worship and allow the Spirit of God to begin to reveal the character of God and begin to call on those names of God. Tell God just who you know Him to be, who you need Him to be. We have to worship, the Scripture says, in spirit and in truth. And so the truth is that God is multifaceted. He can't be placed in a box. Glory be to God. He can't be contained even in here. The human mind is an awesome thing. It baffles scientists. So they can't figure it out. But even this mind is so great and so intricate. God can't be contained even in this mind. He's multifaceted. Amen. There's many sides and manifestations of God. And they're all beneficial to us who recite this. And so we need to get into worship and allow worship to lead us, amen, into reciting and praying the name of God. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. We're going to be moving right on to our next teaching.
My Lord.
I hope I'm not moving too fast.
No, that's good.
I'm trying to keep with time, amen.
Jesus.
Lord of God.
Bless the Lord.
Jesus.
Our next topic is prayer languages. In English and in the spirit. Lord. I said, my God. My God, my God. Holy Ghost, you was going to have to help me with this one. And so sometimes we speak in a language that only God understands. And then sometimes God speaks in a language that we can understand. So praying in English, or your primary language, we'll use English because we're all English speakers here, amen. Amen. Praying in English helps to develop our relationship with God. It's very vital. And I say, Lord, well, you might have to help me because, you know, some people, they just, you know, go to heaven up over there all day. And they're like, no. And so we need to pray in English to develop our relationship with God. I have a few friends that I've met in middle school, and they are all deaf. And I used to ride the bus with them. And it was very hard to communicate with them. And they would be going, because they taught me a few things. I'm like, wait a minute, you're going too fast, too furious, I don't understand a word. Let's write this down, let's slow it down. And so having a relationship with someone who doesn't speak your language is difficult to, you can't connect to that person on a level of someone who speaks your language.
Right.
It's just not going to happen.
Right.
And so we need to make sure that we are connecting with God in mind and spirit. Amen. And so speaking to Him and confiding in Him and then listening for His response with a heart to obey. Some people wonder why they don't hear from God. You wonder why God is never here. God said, what to you? Why not? I'm never here. Because He knows. God never wastes His anointing. He never wastes His presence. And so why would He pour out something so precious to someone who doesn't have a heart to hear and obey? And so listening for His response, whether it be approval or correction, is what moves us from mere servant to friend. Let's go to John chapter 15, verse 14. And so we need to move from being just a servant of God, which is awesome in itself. It's a great privilege to just be able to serve God. Amen. But He's opened the door to move us from servant to friend. Glory to God. John 15, 14 through 15. Again, I'm reading in the New Living Translation. You are my friend. This is Jesus speaking. You are my friend if you obey me. I no longer call you servants because a master doesn't confide in servants.
Amen.
Now you are my friends since I have told you everything the Father told me. And so for those who believe that God has left them hanging, something is wrong. There's some static on the line. Amen. You may might need to go back and do a little maintenance because He's already said He's told us everything. Everything that the Father said, He says. And the Father carry it out. And so speaking to God in English develops your faith, because you know what you asked of Him. When you pray to God in English, then you have a track record. You know, hopefully you keep a journal of your prayers, and you can look back and say, wow, I remember praying for this, and see it. You know, I check stuff off and highlight it in my journal, like, wow, God, you did that. Amen. You said this, I asked you this, and you brought it to pass. Glory to God. And so it develops our faith in God. Amen?
Amen.
And it gives us personal relationship and personal testimony. And so as the relationship progresses, our trust grows, and we develop a deep faith in God and everything that He says. So now I know that when I hear God say something, that's it. It's said. Amen? All
right.
And so this leads us to the next major advantage of praying in English. It's praying the scriptures and standing on the promises of God. And so praying the scriptures allows us to see the word of God take on flesh, living and breathing right before our very eyes. Go to John chapter 1. One of these great, great scriptures. St. John chapter 1, verses 1 through 2. Read, in the beginning, the word already existed. Remember who's I am. In the beginning, the word already existed. He was with God, and He was God. He was in the beginning with God. My Lord Jesus. Somebody ain't catching glory to God. In the beginning, the word already existed. He was with God, and He was God. He was in the beginning with God. Will cause you to see Jesus in a real way, just like John did. This is the words of John. And he saw Jesus in a real and tangible way. And so he began to talk about the beginning as if he was there. But John was in the beginning, no, he wasn't. But the Spirit of God that rested on John was there. And so he began to testify and talk about it just like he was there in the beginning. And he said, even though in the beginning the world already existed, yet there in the man Jesus and dwell among us. But that's not when the living word became the living word. The word always was and always is. The scripture say heaven and earth will pass away. And this scripture, a lot of people, they try to look and see, well, that can't mean what it sounds like. Yes, it does. We got to cut heartstrings with the things of this world. These things are more than heaven and earth, everything in it, will pass away, but my word will never pass away. My word always is. And so the word is eternal, and therefore supersedes our temporary circumstance. This too, Pastor, shall pass. My Lord, glory to God. But the word shall forever stand.
Amen.
Go down to verses 3 and 4 in that same chapter, John chapter 1. John 1, 3 and 4 says, He created, we're talking about the Word, He created everything there is. Nothing exists that He didn't make. Life itself was in Him, and this life gives